My name is Stephen Miller, and I am the communications manager at Waubonsee Community College. We have this podcast so that people can learn more about the employees, students, partners, and programs of Waubonsee. Jared Erickson is the coach of the new esports team here. He and I sat down and talked about esports as a college competitive event, what goes into being an esports athlete, and how spectators can experience esports. We hope you enjoy this conversation. Today we're talking to Jared Erickson. He is the coach of Waubonsee's new esports team. So Jared, this is a new program and you're new to the college. So tell us a little bit about yourself and your background and what led you to coaching esports.
Right. Yeah. So I came on here at Waubonsee about 2 months ago now, hired a little bit later in the development of the program. My background being in esports, I've been playing since I was 4 or 5 years old, starting on, you know, basic Nintendo and stuff like that. But coaching esports at the college level definitely takes a little more experience. So I'm not just coming in here as a gamer. I have a background in coaching traditional sports, soccer for many years, and then transitioned into coaching esports when I moved into kind of my adult life, just having a passion for developing players and helping people get better. It's something that, you know, I really love and I was passionate about.
So, okay, that's interesting. So you played and coached soccer, traditional soccer?
Correct.
What do you see as a connection between that kind of experience and playing, coaching esports?
Right. I think there's a lot of values that translate from traditional coaching to coaching an esports team. You look at a lot of the professional teams, they're going to have the same kind of staffing that a soccer or football team would. They have analysts, they have psychologists, they have nutritionists, all that, because it's all important, regardless of the sport being physical or mental. You know, being in shape and healthy plays a part in that, absolutely.
Sure, sure. Very interesting. Okay, so we've talked about your background here. So what are esports? We've mentioned the term esports and traditional sports. So the implication is that esports is something not traditional, seems new and kind of up and coming. What is esports?
Esports at its core, just at a face value, it's competitive video games is what it is. It's been around since early days. You go back to arcades, you know, with like Tekken or Pac-Man or things. There's always been tournaments around it, but it's never been such a large scale because there's never really been a large interest in it. And now that's kind of coming to fruition. The competitive aspect is becoming more mainstream because there's a lot of money backing a lot of programs, whether it's professional, collegiate, anything.
So esports are, as you alluded to, esports are very popular right now. What has led to that? Obviously, technology and the amount of games available and the fact that many people have game systems in their homes. What other things have contributed to this popularity of esports right now?
I think in addition to just the general accessibility of esports, the games that are competitive, anybody can log on and play it. And while they may not be, you know, professional level or very good for many, many years or ever really, they're still able to play it and enjoy it. Whereas, you know, you look at maybe football, that's something that not everybody can play. I played for 2 years. And it was not for me. I enjoyed it, but it definitely is something I enjoy spectating more than playing.
Sure.
But I think another thing that's kind of brought esports to the forefront is the community around it. It's very welcoming. In addition to anybody being able to play it, anybody can join that community. And I find that anytime someone wants to learn how to watch it or learn how to enjoy it, the community around it's very receptive to that. And they want to help you learn so you can enjoy it just as much as they do.
It's interesting. You just said you mentioned the word community a few times, and we being a community college, it seems to kind of fit in well in this environment, this idea of people coming together to learn and to compete and participate in activities. So from a spectator perspective, you know, why should someone who does not participate in esports be interested in or care about this, and how does a person get into this as a spectator?
I think initially when you start watching it, it's going to be very foreign. It's very difficult to understand. Just the heads-up display that you're going to be looking at when you're watching a match is sometimes difficult to follow. So I think the best way to start is by finding somebody who already watches it or is somewhat familiar with it and get them involved, because they're going to help you learn a lot faster. For myself, we'll go to a traditional sport that I'm not really familiar with, something like cricket.
That's exactly the reference I was thinking about. How would someone explain cricket? But go ahead.
Right. If you sit down and try to watch cricket on your own, you're probably not going to understand it. The analysts or the commentators, which are present in esports, any competitive match is going to have commentators. they're going to be talking about the game, and you'll kind of be able to glean a few things from that. But if you're sitting down with somebody that actually plays cricket or knows it, you're going to understand the game a lot faster than you would if they weren't.
So, okay, so Waubonsee has a new esports program. We'll talk more specifically about that in just a minute. But how can one begin to observe and participate in this program? When what's the timeline, and when does it start, and when and where can someone be involved in this as a spectator?
I think kind of parents and students here that are interested in supporting the program and watching it, just making sure they're watching on like the GoCheeps website or the GoCheeps Twitter. We are making announcements regularly. Anybody who wants to be a part of the community Discord around Waubonsee Esports, Discord is an app that's used. It's on computers, on your phone as well. It's just like a community chat. It's a little bit safer than some of the other ones out there. We have a lot of announcements going out there, but if they want to start supporting it, we should be playing matches sometime in February after we complete our tryout sessions.
Okay, nice. So specifically about the program here at Waubonsee. So what games will be competed in? And just talk about the program specifically here at Waubonsee. What are we playing, and how do you make the team and all these kinds of things? Whatever you got to say.
Sure. So right now we're kind of committed to two games in particular, League of Legends, which is probably the biggest esport in the world, largest money pools, consistent player salaries, chances to go pro. There's probably 200 professional players in the U.S. alone. And we're also going to be running Rocket League. Both of those teams are going to run tryouts in late January, early February. And once we have those rosters established, we'll actually start playing in matches and competing. So our timeline around it is still kind of fuzzy because we're waiting on our construction to finish up in Ericsson 213. So
okay, so we're playing at Waubonsee. Our teams will be competing primarily in a couple of games called League of Legends and one called Rocket League. Tell us a little about those. What are those games about?
Sure. So Rocket League is a 3-on-3 soccer game. It's soccer played with cars, so it's a little unique in that factor. The cars are able to fly as well. It takes a lot of mechanical ability, a lot of skill to be able to pilot those. So we're hoping to find some good players for that. And then League of Legends is a 5-on-5 cooperative game. It's a little more complex to get into the game in its entirety, but knowing that it's 5-on-5, it's pretty much all you need to know to start watching it. And then you'll understand and pick up things as you continue to view it.
So walk us through a match of League of Legends and Rocket League. What does it look like from the perspective of a player and or the perspective of a spectator? What is this experience like? How do you win? You know, what is the experience?
Sure. So in a traditional setup where we're going to be watching our matches and having them streamed or broadcasted for anybody to view, when it comes to Rocket League, we'll have pregame commentary. So we'll have two analysts talking, or one analyst possibly, talking about how the game's going to unfold. And they're going to talk about the roster strengths and who we're playing against as well. A lot of that pregame scouting will be done on my part and shared with them so that they're able to talk about it. But Rocket League, same way soccer is played, you're trying to score goals. It's a set amount of time. Usually in Rocket League, it's set up as a best of three. So they're going to play three games and one total match. So those games are going to be broken down into 2 5-minute halves. And they're going to play against each other, try to score the most goals at the end of the game. They can go into overtime if they're still tied. And that's pretty much it for Rocket League.
So it sounds like it's a fast-paced game, 2 5-minute halves and flying cars and, you know, scoring goals. It sounds pretty fast action. Is that?
Yeah. It's a lot of fun to watch. There's a lot going on. As you start to watch the game, you'll understand a little bit more about the little nuances of it, being able to like angle the ball off the wall because it's played in an enclosed arena. So there's no out of bounds. So it is constant action. If you've ever watched, think maybe hockey, the puck really doesn't go out of play that much. So there's no breaks in the game. It's just constantly going.
Yeah, years ago I watched an Arena League football game, and
those are
the same
great
kind of thing. It was that big, you could just check people into the walls and the ball does not go out of bounds. It is pretty fascinating. So
yeah, Rocket League has a unique feature where you have access to something called boost, and what that does is it makes your car go faster, and you can use it to actually ram into enemy players and destroy their cars.
So you're talking soccer with cars. So what's the, and you just mentioned boost, the ability to go faster. What's the the size of the, and you mentioned it's an arena. What's the size? I mean, how much space is covered here?
Sure. So 6 players total. There's enough room in the game to kind of move around and position yourself in a way where you're predicting the enemy's next move. So whoever you're playing against, if they're going to hit the ball at a certain angle, being able to predict where that ball is going to go and making a play on it that way is pretty common. All players are involved during the match, so it's not going to be one person is assigned as the goalie. Everybody plays offense. Everybody plays defense. Kind of, again, we'll go back to the hockey analogy where defensemen can come up and score goals as well. It's the same idea in Rocket League, except there's no permanent goalie.
Okay. Interesting. Okay. Talk a little about League of Legends. What's that like?
Sure. So League of Legends, again, when you start watching it, there should be pregame commentary. It's going to go a little more in depth. There's going to be some terminology and verbiage that's used that people may be unfamiliar with. Again, that's where you're going to benefit from having somebody that's familiar with the game there with you. But a good analyst is going to try to make it as broad and understandable by everyone as possible. So if you start watching it and there's things that you maybe don't understand, don't feel left out. You'll come to understand them in time. At the end of the day, when you watch the match, it's all going to play out the same way. So when you load into the game, the very first thing that the players are going to go through is something called pick and ban phase. What that is, the teams are essentially selecting 5 characters, unique characters that they're going to play, and they're going to be different than what the other team has. So when you load in, you're going to have a ban phase first, which is where you're going to select champions that the enemy team doesn't get to play. So there's over 150 champions in League of Legends right now. There's a lot of unique characters you can play, all with their own unique ability sets. And if you know that the enemy team plays certain champions very well, you can choose to ban some of those out or make sure that they don't have them.
So the term ban is keeping the other team from getting, is banning them from using those players?
Correct. Correct. That's just going to be for one game, though. Yep. So League of Legends is generally played as a best of 3 as well. I think during the regular season, we'll probably do best of 1s. That's usually how it is in terms of matches. So once that initial ban phase is complete, each champion is going to be picked in an order based on what side of the map that you play on. So you either play on the bottom side, which is the blue side, or the top side, which is the red side. There's really no advantage to either side in terms of playing the game, except during that initial phase where you're picking your champions. If you're on blue side, you have the very first pick of the game, so you get to pick whoever you want. And then on the red side, you have the very last pick. So it gives you an opportunity to maybe pick something that's really good into the enemy team. You can counter the pick. So those first 3 picks happen. Then it's going to go into a second ban phase where you're going to kind of analyze what the enemy has picked so far. And then you get to ban out additional champions. And then you're going to finish picking to round out your team comp. And that's it. The entire time that's happening, you're going to have analysts talking about the match, about where they know specific team strengths are, or where the enemy team's weaknesses are, and what they can kind of focus on. So it's kind of like a pregame analysis. Whenever you watch an NFL match, especially with the playoffs having just happened, they talk about the game for 4 or 5 hours before it even happens. For League of Legends, that's going to happen in about a span of 30 or 45 minutes.
Okay, interesting. So then the nature of this game, League of Legends, it's so what is going on? You mentioned the map and, you know, blue side, red side. What is the terrain like? What is the competition like?
So League of Legends is pretty simple when it comes to the map. It's broken down into 3 separate lanes, which is top lane, mid lane, and bottom lane. And what that lane is, it's a direct path to the enemy base. Now, along each of these lanes, there's 3 towers, and these towers are protected and fortified and very hard to kill. But the only way you can destroy them is if you actually are able to get up to them and get your you have these minions that spawn in your lane every 30 seconds, and they're going to walk down the lane automatically. There's nothing that could influence them or change their path. Their goal is to go down that lane all the way to the enemy base. And when they meet with one another, they fight each other. They generally don't mess with you unless you mess with them. So when you're on your champion and you're in one of those lanes, if you're able to destroy those minions on the enemy side and get your minions into the enemy tower, it makes it a little bit easier to destroy them. Now, in addition to the lanes, you also have the parts in between the lanes, which is known as the jungle. And in the jungle, there are neutral camps or neutral monsters that you can fight. And generally, the only person who's going to fight those is your jungler on your team. That's one of the positions in League of Legends. So your jungler essentially roams around the map in between the lanes, destroying those camps. That's how he levels up, and that's how he gets gold. That's his economy through that jungle area. And then he can look to influence any of the lanes that he wants to go into. So he can essentially create a situation where it's a 2-on-1 or a 3-on-2 or however it is. Now, the enemy has one of these as well, and you don't get to see them because that area is blacked out on the map. So it's very, you got to kind of predict where they're going to go. So a lot of the early stages of the game are spent in the lane specifically, and you're going to be wherever your position is. And you're kind of waiting for the jungler to come and influence the map. As the game progresses and as towers are destroyed and as objectives on the map are going to spawn, the objectives are pretty obvious when a team is going to fight over them. There's usually a lot of action. And generally when there's an objective, it has a magnetic effect where all the teams want it. So you're going to have more than just a 1-on-1 fight. You could have a full team fight where it's 3-on-3 or 4-on-4. Sure. You could have full 5-on-5.
Sure. So how much time, you mentioned the Rocket League game is 2 halves of 5 minutes. What's the timeline for a League of Legends game and match?
I'd say an average League of Legends game is going to run about 25 to 30 minutes. Okay. That's just the match itself, not including the earlier part. A full game, probably about 60 minutes with analysis, pre and post game. It can go upwards of 50 or 60 minutes. It depends on how the team's played. But the game nowadays, the way it's kind of been fixed and organized to happen, they want it to be a faster paced game. And there's elements that'll come into the game later in the time that'll actually help you speed up the pace of the game.
Sure. Okay. So let's talk more about this in terms of Waubonsee. So we've got these two games at Waubonsee. Who will the Waubonsee team be competing against? What is the competition field? Who participates? And then we'll talk about where these matches happen at.
Sure. Yeah. So Waubonsee, this is really a unique aspect of esports. They can play anybody in the nation. We can go from Friday playing against the University of California, Irvine. And then the very next day we could play Miami of Ohio. Since it's all online, the matches are able to happen in real time. You don't have to travel anywhere. As long as you have access to good internet and you have your computers, we're able to compete in our own arena against other teams. When it comes to what we're going to be playing in, there's a couple of leagues we have in mind. For League of Legends, we're going to be participating in something called GG Leagues, which is a Midwest-only competition that's for colleges in the area. So that'll be a more localized tournament, and that's all going to be online as well. Should our team perform really well in that and we make it to the finals, the company does put on a very fun in-person finals. So we would actually travel to a center and get to play against another team.
Okay, so given that most of these will probably happen in one location for now, what is that location? What is your space like? What do we have here at Waubonsee as far as space where our team will be competing?
So we actually have a huge arena under development right now that's going to have state-of-the-art equipment. It's going to be decked out with logos and decals, and it's going to feel like a truly competitive space where our team is going to be reserved to play. That's where we practice. That's where we play. That's where everything happens, right in there. There will be a more social aspect to that area. So half of the room will be dedicated to a competitive space, which is where our varsity athletes and our junior varsity athletes will practice. And then we'll also have another half of that room that'll be dedicated to more of a social gathering where our clubs that are involved with esports or our video games or anything like that will be able to come in and kind of hang out.
And this space is in Erickson Hall here on the Sugar Grove campus, correct?
Correct.
And Erickson Hall is the home of the Waubonsee Athletics program, so all the teams are there. So,
correct.
So this esports team is a competitive team within the athletics department. So talk about that fit. How does this, what is the relationship of this sport to other sports on the campus, given that this is a new and upcoming program here at the college?
Right. Myself, I am part of the athletics department as the head coach of esports here at Waubonsee. I work out of the athletic offices just like any of our other coaches, baseball, volleyball, whatever it is. I work directly with the athletic director. That's who I report to, Dana Wagner. She's fantastic to work with. She's super supportive of this program and really excited to get it going. In terms of our athletes, we have uniforms. I have scholarship funding that I'm able to offer any kids that I feel like they should play here. I really want them to play here. Everything that athletics has access to, we have access to.
You're talking about scholarships and getting athletes and things. So do area high schools have this program? And what is the what is the pipeline for these kind of athletes? I know high school or, you know, colleges are recruiting football and basketball and baseball athletes from the time they're in probably in middle school at this point. What is the talent pipeline for this program?
So I have access to the same high schools that are in district as our regular athletics do. They recruit from the schools that are in our specific district. That's who we can offer scholarships to. If they're out of district, we can't offer the scholarships, but they can still come and play for us. I recruit the exact same way our other athletics department do. I go into the schools. Not all of the schools have esports programs. I know Oswego is a big recruiting ground. They have very active programs, very good teams there. And it's the same way that you would approach a traditional athletics recruiting, where you go in, you talk to the athletes, you get them involved, you can have them come and tour the campus. I do have a unique advantage where a lot of the statistics that you have to maybe sometimes even pay for to get access to when it comes to those high school level athletes, I can simply go online and look up their profile for whatever game that they play. And I can research them that way and kind of see very cut and dry what the statistics are like on paper. It's still good to get out there and talk to the athletes, of course, you know, assess personalities. But
so I guess you'll get out to area high schools and watch, you know, watch them compete, I guess, or I guess you wouldn't even have to go to it, because you can probably just jump online and observe the matches of the high school. Is that correct?
You know, that is possible. It kind of depends on the high school streaming capabilities. General matches that are just played, unless it's going to be streamed through some competitive high school circuit, which there are a few out there. I don't know if all the schools or any of the schools are necessarily involved in those. The only way to really watch them is to have them submit kind of a VOD or a video on demand to you, and then I can watch it that way. But for the most part, I do have to go to the schools to watch them play.
Interesting. Okay. So we've talked about, you know, that the program here and you know, kind of the fact that this is already in high schools and things. What do esport athletes do after college? Let's say somebody comes here and they've you know, maybe this is something they want to do, is kind of a something fun to do, a competitive thing to do while in college, but you mentioned earlier something about, you know, the professional aspect of this, whether it be in the esports field after college. What do esport athletes do? What can they do? I mean, in terms of
some of the avenues that are open to
them. Yeah, some of the avenues, exactly. Better term. Yeah. I mean, is this an avenue to things you know, outside of esports? Like, is this, you know, a pathway to something in, you know, I don't know, cyber something or tech industry, something else? Talk to us about what these athletes do.
So it's actually really unique in the fact that, you know, with the accessibility, anybody being able to play this, I could have an English major, I can have a math major, I can have a chemistry major, all on the same team. I may have somebody that's not even in the IT or computer science field playing for the team. When it comes to what you're going to do afterwards, it's really important that you focus on education and get your degree, because that's going to be your security. I think as esports continues to develop, there's more and more opportunities within the field in terms of playing, in terms of being an analyst or a broadcaster or a coach. A lot of the things that you look at with traditional athletics in terms of playing, what you do afterwards, is very similar with esports. So if you want to be a psychologist for a team, you can work as a psychologist for a team. If you want to be a production manager for one of the professional scenes, you can do that. In terms of how accessible it is, it's not as wide as, say, the NFL, who has, 32 teams and cities all across the U.S. Most of the professional scene for esports is out on the West Coast in California. So that's where you're going to end up.
But even so, outside of the esports industry, the idea of competition, of collegiate level competition, is good. That most college athletes don't make a career of playing football,
right,
or baseball or basketball or anything else. They use the opportunity to compete and get that sense of competition, and they're better off for it. And that's true of not just athletes, but, you know, musicians and marching band competitions, and there's a whole host of competition available. And this is just another one of those for people who are interested in this field. So I think it's really fascinating. Okay, so I've always felt that I should be the first baseman for the St. Louis Cardinals. There are a lot of people who disagree with me, though, and therefore I'm not a first baseman. I'm not the first baseman for the St. Louis Cardinals. So in this discipline of esports, what makes an esport athlete? What is it that separates a casual player from a collegiate level player?
To be a collegiate level athlete, what do you need to do? You really need to take care of your body. You need to make sure you're sharp mentally and physical. You have to understand your game. You have to practice your game. and you have to be consistent. We look for the same thing in esports athletes. We want people that are generally in shape. I want my athletes to participate in the physical regimen that I've put in place for our program. You think esports, they're just playing video games, right? Well, no, we have to be in physical shape as well. Having good posture, stretching beforehand, that's all stuff that's a given. But actually working out and taking care of your body, I believe there is a direct correlation between physical shape and mental shape. If you're in shape, you're healthy, you're going to be able to perform better. You're going to be able to perform for longer. And then, you know, our esports athletes, we want them to be healthy in terms of what they're eating. And we want them to be healthy in terms of their lifestyle. We want to be mindful in our practices. We don't want to be practicing for, you know, 3 hours here and then have them go home and play for another 4 hours. That's not mindful practice. There's going to be diminishing returns if you spend all day playing the game. And I think one of the biggest things we look for in our athletes here is we want positive attitudes. It's very difficult to keep that because at the top level of, we'll say, League of Legends play, unfortunately, the in-game community around it is fairly toxic. There's a lot of people, because it's so accessible, even if you're in the top, you know, 4,000 or 5,000 players in the U.S., I'd say a good 4,000 of those have pretty poor attitudes. If they're losing in the game early on, they don't believe in comebacks. And it's very difficult to play in that environment. So being mentally stout, being strong and able to play from a position where you're losing is definitely important. Because when you're on a team, you know, even if you're down 38-0 in a football game, for the most part, everybody on that sideline feels like they can still win. They're going to put on a face that says, hey, we're still in this game. Let's go out there and start one score at a time. Same thing with any esports athlete.
Interesting. So it sounds, as you're saying that, I'm thinking about the term that comes to mind is kind of a whole of life approach, just making good athletes broadly and good citizens, good, you know, you talked about good attitude, just the idea of competing for the sake of competition all the way through to the end. And I've heard the term with like track athletes, you push through to the finish line. And so that's it, whether you're down or up and just being good sports. That's really tremendous. Great insight. So esports is a new thing. And we've already talked about kind of like why it's popular now, but for someone who is not interested, who doesn't really know anything about esports now, either as a spectator or a participant, why should they be interested in this right now?
Right. You may not have any friends or family that are directly involved in it, but I can almost guarantee everybody out there has a niece, a nephew, a cousin, a neighbor, somebody who is actively involved in it. It's over a $1 billion industry. Last year, there were over 4 or 5 million viewers for the League of Legends World Championship. Just in the U.S. alone, there were 200 million worldwide watching it. It's only growing. And if you end up behind the curve, well, I'm sure you have a friend who maybe doesn't watch football and you think they're kind of weird. You don't want to be the guy who's kind of weird, who's not familiar with something. So get involved now.
Fair point.
And people are always going to be receptive to you. If you have a friend or a family member who's into it, ask them about it. And I'm sure they're more than happy to share their passion with you. Because generally, at least with esports, if you watch it, you play it. And if you don't play it, that's okay. We want you to come and watch it. We want you to be involved. We want to have the fans, the cheering arenas, and our athletes here at Waubonsee are going to deserve that all the same. So we encourage you to come out, even if you're unfamiliar, get involved. We want you around.
So Jared, tell us a little bit about the event. With everything, there's advantages and disadvantages and reasons to do something, reasons not to do something. What are some of those features of esports?
Of course. So some of the advantages of participating in esports is the low physical commitment in terms of strain on your body. There's really not a lot of physical strain unless you're sitting with improper posture, you're not stretching beforehand or anything like that. You're generally going to be healthier than the average athlete in terms of staying healthy. Some of the disadvantages, however, are you are prone to the common diseases of esports or anything that uses your hands. You think a pianist, a gamer, somebody who golfs a lot even, or tennis, things like that. You know, you can have and develop bad carpal tunnel syndrome. You can have wrist problems. And that all comes down to making sure when you're practicing, one thing we preach here to our teams is being mindful, you know, with everything. Make sure you're sitting with proper posture. And that starts with equipment. We have awesome gaming chairs in the arena that are going to be there that's going to help our athletes stay healthy and perform well while they're playing and not have to worry about that.
What what's the time commitment? I mean, there's, you mentioned practice and there's obviously that, but for someone who's interested in this, what is, what's time commitment involved?
Sure. It's really not more than your average sport. You know, we're asking our athletes to come in and practice three times a week. We practice for generally 2 to 3 hours at a time. That's not strictly playing. I'd say that most of the time kids, if they're practicing at home, and I air quotes around practicing, they're sitting down and they're playing for 3 or 4 hours nonstop. That's not practice. That's you spending a lot of time playing a game that you enjoy. There's nothing wrong with that. But if it develops into a bad habit and you're not participating in traditional athletics, or you're not trying to keep yourself, you know, up in school and keeping your grades up, then it's a bad time commitment.
Sure.
But if you're doing well in all other aspects, you're active, your grades are great, you're doing what your parents are telling you to do, then you're in good shape to play as long as you want. And if you're good and you're participating in tournaments, that's fantastic. Obviously, your time isn't being wasted. When it comes to the college level, however, when my athletes are here and they're practicing, I don't really want them playing outside of practice time. If that's how they want to spend some of their free time, because this is a passion, this is a hobby, something people really enjoy, and it's accessible, right? If you go and practice football, the chances of you finding a pickup game of football outside of that practice is pretty slim. So it's hard for you to play outside of there. Whereas with games and esports, you can go straight home and continue playing. And a lot of these athletes have that passion. They want to continue playing and playing. But it's important to be mindful of your practice, because you really do get diminishing returns as you start hitting that 3 or 4 hour mark. And with our practices, you know, we'll spend maybe an hour and a half of it playing, but a lot of it is doing video review, rewatching matches, understanding where mistakes happen, how to avoid them, things like that.
This is so fascinating. So we're here at Waubonsee, we're starting off the starting this program with two games, League of Legends and Rocket League. Why those two games?
So when we initially looked at games here at Waubonsee, we kind of had an idea of what we maybe wanted to run. We had looked at the NJCAA and the games that they're sanctioning as possible games to run. The games that they were offering were Super Smash Bros., Madden, NFL 20, and Rocket League. And out of those three, we decided to go with Rocket League strictly because of the fact it's a little bit larger of a team. I get 3 varsity and 3 junior varsity athletes for that. And also the longevity of the game. Madden and Super Smash Bros. Are all going to be releasing a new game every other year. And within the esports industry, as new games fade in and out, you know, Fortnite just came in 2 or 3 years ago, and it's still huge. It obviously had a model that was designed to make it successful in the long term. But in 4 or 5 years, there's no guarantee that Fortnite is still going to be played even. I'm sure there will be some players for it, but it might not be as popular because a new game may come in. Whereas with Rocket League, that's something that's probably a staple that's going to stay. There's nothing that can change within the game that's going to make it very different than what it is now. It's not going to be vastly different. It's still going to be soccer, and the goal of the game is still going to be the same. So that has a good longevity. That's a program we can run multiple years in a row here without worrying about it fading out. And then with League of Legends, that's been competitive for 8 or 9 years now. And it's something that's only grown every year with teams franchising, with NBA teams owning teams in the league. The Golden State Warriors own the Golden Guardians. The Houston Rockets just sold their team in the league to the Philadelphia 76ers. So there's a lot of money invested in it. And because League of Legends is so popular, we have a wider player base, which means for us, recruitment is easier, and it means the popularity is going to be there.
Sure. So it sounds like it seems like there would also be the opportunity over time for new games to be added that the college could choose to participate in as well.
Absolutely. And the cool thing is, you know, just based on the population in the area and how large Waubonsee is, we have so many students here. Chances are we could find players that could compete in the games.
Sure.
But the important thing is, if we're going to bring a new game onto the roster, we need to see interest in it.
Sure.
And the way we see interest in it is we look at our local community high school, see what kind of teams they have, because we want that talent developed early. I don't want to pull 6 players out of their home who have no competitive gaming experience, didn't get a chance to play in high school, maybe because it wasn't accessible to them. There might be a few, you know, diamonds in the rough that I could find to bring in to play on those teams. But if I have 6 average level players that want to compete, chances are I could coach them and make them good players. But if they don't have that natural talent there, then we're probably not going to do very well. And ultimately, we do want to perform well in all the games we have in our programs.
Sure, of course, yeah. You mentioned the National Basketball Association being involved in this. That's interesting. You also mentioned the NJCAA, the National Junior College Athletic Association, the games that are sanctioned. So this isn't just something that Waubonsee is doing on its own. There is a lot of heavy hitters involved in this, the National Junior College Athletic Association and the NBA and others. So there's a lot of, you mentioned the growth and the number of people participating, but it's not just individuals. There's a lot of organizational backing behind this program and this industry in general. So Jared, it's been great talking to you. I've learned much, and I think people who listen to this will learn a great deal about esports and what it's doing at Waubonsee, why it's here, and what it will bring. And I think it's really, really an exciting time and an exciting thing for students, for sure, and for the college. And so look forward to having you back on and talking about this more, maybe at the end of the season and kind of see where we're at and see how it went and talk about the future of esports at Waubonsee.
Yeah, for sure. And you know, if there's anybody out there who has any questions, any parents, any students that don't know what it is and is interested in it, you can find me on our athletics page. You can send me an email. I'd happily sit down with you or have an email chain and kind of talk about what it is and answer any questions you may have. Because if you're uninvolved, we do want you involved, and come out and support us when you can.
Nice, great. All right, thanks.